Contamos con la visita de Tony Bennett. Tony Bennett es profesor e investigador de la Universidad de Western Sydney, siendo su especialidad la teoría social y cultural. Su carrera académica ha transcurrido en universidades de Australia y Gran Bretaña, incursionando desde diversos ángulos en el territorio de la sociología de la cultura. Su trabajo oscila entre las ciencias sociales y las humanidades, y sus aportes más significativos se contabilizan en las áreas de los estudios culturales, la teoría literaria, la sociología cultural y los estudios referidos al origen y al desarrollo de los museos como instituciones públicas al servicio del principio de gubernamentalidad de las sociedades modernas. Dotado de una potente capacidad de elucidación teórica que se inspira, entre otros autores, en las contribuciones de Bourdieu y Foucault, su trabajo ha planteado nuevas formas de comprender el fenómeno literario y ha liderado la exploración de la cultura popular y el análisis de las políticas culturales, además de situarse en el origen de la nueva museología. Tony Bennett ha escrito varios libros en colaboración con otros autores, algunos de ellos como Modesto Gallo, profesor de la facultad, y otros tantos libros en solitario, por ejemplo, The Birth of the Museum, Past Beyond Memory, y Making Culture, Changing Society, que es su último libro, del 2013, en base al cual se origina las reflexiones de la conferencia que ahora nos va a presentar.
First of all, let me thank Professor Nkuna for those kind words of introduction, but also for inviting me here to give the Norbert Lechner lecture. I'm very pleased and honored to be doing this in view of Professor Lechner's signal contributions to the development of the social sciences in Chile and in Latin America. When I was invited to give this lecture and asked what topics might be of interest, Professor Nkuna had no hesitation in saying something on the politics of method, he said. This suited me very well, while also presenting something of a challenge. It suited me as an indication of the changing critical temper of our times, and one I'm very much in sympathy with, in which our engagement with questions concerning the politics of knowledge have changed significantly, as the moment of theory has given way to what some people now call the moment of method. That is, rather than being approached abstractly as a matter of the influence of ideas, questions concerning the politics of knowledge now more typically concern the impact of the knowledge or method assemblages in which the role of theories and concepts is assessed as inextricably connected to the role of the method instruments and devices with which such concepts and theories are entangled. There is now a good deal of work of this kind in which debates about method have shifted away from a concern with the ability to accurately capture a pre-existing reality to questions focused on the role of methods in making and mobilizing new objects and realities, new agents in the field of knowledge, and with the political capacities of these objects and agents. Most of this work, though, has been developed within and has focused on the social sciences, examining the new realities that have been produced by social surveys, public opinion, research, censuses, economic statistics, or marketing techniques, and the roles that these have played in political processes, the roles that they've played in the governance of populations and identities, and the role that they've played in the production of national economies and the organization of markets. And most of this work, it's important to add, has been informed by a move away from social or constructivist conceptions of the ways in which knowledges work, to stress instead their ontological force as socio-technical actors within the real. Okay. Although the details of their approaches may vary, this, what I've just said, is a common signature, a rough summary of the kind of approaches that we associate with actor network theory, assemblage theory, performativity theory. Okay. So that's a now a rough summary of what is now a burgeoning literature focused on the social life of methods, as some people call them. But while in sympathy with this tendency, it also presents something of a challenge for me, given that it has been developed mainly with regard to the social sciences, whereas my own work that has been concerned with the social role of knowledges has focused largely on disciplines associated with the histories of collecting. Disciplines like archaeology, natural history, aesthetics, and what I'm going to talk about today, anthropology. I have in recent work been concerned with these questions, the role of knowledge is concerned with collecting practices, their political role. I've recently been concerned with these questions in two contexts which relate to the different parts of my title for today. Making Culture, Changing Society, the first part of my title. Anthropology and the Culture Concept, the second. Making Culture, Changing Society is the title of a book that I've just published. And very rarely for authors of academic books, I want to say to you, I'm ad-libbing now, don't buy this book. At least don't buy it now because it's only available in hard copy, and in 2 months' time it'll be coming out in paperback and will be quarter of the price. So don't buy this book. Wait. So I've been working on these questions in two contexts which relate to the different parts of my title. Making Culture, Changing Society has been an umbrella title for a project I've been working on for a number of years, some of the key elements of which are brought together in this book. And my concern in this book is to suggest new terms for thinking about the relations between culture and society in developing a set of intersections between Foucauldian governmentality theory, particularly Foucault's account of liberal government, and the perspectives of actor network and assemblage theory and the tradition of science studies as pioneered by Bernard Latour. So one of the things that I want to do today is to outline the implications of these lines of inquiry for our approach to how we think about the relationships between culture and society, particularly with a view to understanding the forms of action that different cultural knowledges have been associated with the forms of action on the social that have been associated with the history of different cultural disciplines. This then leads me to the second part of my title, for I shall, after outlining some of the general principles on these matters, explore their implications for the anthropological concept of culture as a way of life, as elaborated in the tradition of American anthropology pioneered by Franz Boas. This second aspect of my presentation draws on work that I'm conducting as part of a project funded by the Australian Research Council, which coordinates an international team in examining the relations between early 20th century anthropological fieldwork, centres of collection, like museums, and the governance of both colonial and metropolitan populations. And one of my roles in this project has been to look at the relationship between the museum and the fieldwork practices of Franz Boas. And I have, in pursuing these concerns, found that they've provided me with a point of entry into a much larger and longer, and for me, more interesting history concerning the role played by the anthropological concept of culture as ways of life, in the development of liberal forms of government, which I want to approach these questions not by looking at liberal government in the abstract, but looking at the role played in the development of practices of liberal government by the anthropological concept of culture as part of a new set of method assemblages. Okay, that's a rough summary then of the route I'm going to follow in this talk. So let me now come back to my first concern, which is how to engage with the forms of action on the social that have been tied up with the history of different concepts of culture. And I want to make just four points here, and I can best make the first point by quoting a passage from Bruno Latour's Reassembling the Social, in which Latour writes that culture does not act surreptitiously behind the actor's back. This most sublime production is manufactured at specific places and institutions, be it the messy office of the top floor of Marshall Sahlin's house on the Chicago campus, or the thick area files kept in the Pitt Rivers Museum in Oxford. So there are two aspects to Latour's argument here. The first is the contention that culture is the result of a work of ordering on the part of intellectual authorities, in this case the two anthropologists that he cites, Marshall Sahlins and the late 19th century generation of armchair anthropologists whose work in classifying and ordering the collection of ethnographic materials that were brought together in the Pitt Rivers Museum in Oxford represented the heyday of evolutionary colonial anthropology. But the tourist's second contention is that this work of ordering takes place in custom-built settings, like Marshall Sahlin's office or the archives of a museum. This is not to suggest that the work of culture should be limited to what anthropologists do in settings like museums. This is not to suggest that the work of making up new forms of culture and their actions on the social is limited to such settings. The argument is a more general one concerning the need to attend to the many different customized settings in which culture is made. The television, film or recording studio, the art gallery, archives, libraries, universities, statistical surveys of cultural tastes, for example, and to engage with the different forms of expertise and authority that are in play in such settings, expertise ranging across art history, aesthetics, musicology, and so on. The work of classifying and ordering that takes place in such settings is informed by and helps to shape particular concepts of culture understood as distinctive ways of ordering the relations between texts, practices, and things. What has then to be attended to are the ways in which such processes of making culture in these customized settings are then connected to programs that are aimed at changing society. And this involves a consideration of the capacities that are attributed to culture and the forms of conduct or sets of social relations to which those capacities are then applied in programs of would-be managed programs of social change. Okay. The second principle undermining approach to the action of culture is that the forms of expertise and authority that are involved in the processes of making culture and changing society are to be understood as, in the Foucauldian sense, parts of specific regimes of truth, and that these regimes of truth function as parts of modern forms of governmentality. They play, I also want to argue, a particularly important role in relation to the logics of liberal government and the distribution of the forms of and capacities for freedom through which liberal forms of government, in Foucault's account, operate. This is a key aspect of the work performed by culture concepts, which have, from their origins in modern aesthetics and through unto the present, worked to differentiate populations along raced, classed, and gendered lines in terms of the capacities for freedom that liberal forms of government require, produce, and work through. Such understandings of the relations between culture and freedom have played a key role in defining the limits of liberal political community through the exclusions that such divisions effect. So one of my concerns today is to identify the ways in which cultural disciplines have acted as authorities of freedom that have been tied up with the processes through which freedom, understood not as an innate or natural given, but as a set of produced capacities, the ways in which freedom as a set of produced capacities has been variably distributed across different populations so as to place them differently, either within or outside practices of liberal government, to govern them either freely or to rule them coercively. My third principle is that the role played by culture concepts in these regards has to be understood not abstractly as the influence of ideas in constructing social realities, but as parts of complex assemblages in which ideas and concepts, texts and persons, tools and technologies commingle. The intersections between such assemblages, libraries, the media, museums, studios, art galleries, constitute a distinctive institutional ensemble in modern societies. And it is these intersections and their relations to the social that constitute the realities that cultural analysis, sociocultural analysis, must engage with. I've thus proposed, for example, that the practical histories in which anthropology have been entangled at different moments in its history are best approached as parts of anthropological assemblages. Such assemblages encompass, Such assemblages encompass in the case of the early 20th century development of fieldwork anthropology, they encompass one, the whole set of relations and processes from origin and conception which condition anthropologists' roots into conceptions of a mode of entry into the field, including the role of anthropological discourses, such as the discourse of culture, of man, of the environment, or of race, within such processes. They encompass, second, the relations between anthropologists and other agents, human agents such as guides and informants, and non-human agents, the measuring instruments that anthropologists took with them into the field, or the modes of transport, how they got there, whether by camel or by rail. These human and non-human agents that informed the more immediate fieldwork context in which data is collected and subject to initial processing. Three, anthropological assemblages encompass the routes through which anthropologists return to base, the mechanisms through which the materials and data they have collected are subject to institutionally specific processes of ordering and classification. And four, they include the manner in which such materials and data are connected to the institutions and networks through which, whether in the public sphere or in relation to the tasks of colonial administration or both, anthropology is governmentally deployed by either state or non-state actors to bring about changes in the conduct of specific populations. My fourth and final principle regarding how we should envisage the ways in which the work of culture that is enacted in the culture complex is brought to bear on the social is one that I take another leaf from the work of Foucault in order to describe. In his course of lectures on the birth of biopolitics, Foucault argues that modern governmental technologies do not work on society or on the economy directly in order to bring about changes, the changes in conduct that they seek to effect. They rather, he argues, do so indirectly by working through the transactional realities, a phrase he uses, transactional realities, that are produced by the intellectual authorities, by the regimes of truth, which inform the operation of such governmental technologies. He regards, for example, civil society not as a natural given, but as a transactional reality that is historically specific and that has been produced by modern forms of knowledge as a means of engaging with and shaping conduct, ways that are specific to modern forms of governmentality. In a similar way, then, the cultural knowledges that I've been concerned with, art history, aesthetics, archaeology, heritage studies, anthropology, need to be interrogated to identify the transactional realities that they have produced and through which their work on the social is effected. The particular transactional realities produced by these disciplines comprise or are often associated with different concepts of culture. Different concepts of culture which produce what I call in my book different working surfaces on the social. Working surfaces on the social. We need to look at the role that cultural knowledges play in order to connect with the social, not directly, but through the different working surfaces on the social that their concepts produce. The work performed by such culture concepts is crucial in providing the grids through which two things are brought together. First, the kinds of qualities, capacities, and affordances that are attributed to culture. The kinds of actions it is equipped to undertake. And these might vary from culture being thought of as a resource that can be used to reform manners, to manage identities, to govern economies, and so on. And second, we need to look to those aspects of the social, the particular beliefs, forms of conduct, and mode of interrelation relating to the populations upon which the action of culture is to be brought to bear. These working surfaces on the social associated with the histories of the cultural disciplines have taken a number of different forms, ranging from the conceptions of race informing colonial uses of culture as a civilizing resource, through to the conception of transnational cultural hybridities informing postmodal conceptions of the form of difference that, for want of a better word, contemporary cultural diversity programs seek to engage with. But it is, I think, the concept of culture as a way of life associated with early 20th century anthropology that has provided perhaps the most influential working surface on the social through which contemporary programs of governance operating at the interfaces of culture and the social have worked. So it's now to try to make my arguments, which so far have been somewhat abstract, more concrete and specific, It's now to this concept in its Boasian American tradition that I want to turn. But I'm going to start with John Dewey, the American philosopher. In his book Freedom and Culture, published in 1939, John Dewey urges that the manner in which liberal political theory had hitherto conceived the relations between government and freedom needed to be rethought in the light of recent discoveries in the field of anthropology. These discoveries, he argued, provided, and I quote, sufficient disproof of the notion that the problem of government, can be stated as one of the relation of the individual and the social, as if these names stood for actual existences, end of quote. In their place, he said, anthropology substitutes culture as the force that relativizes forms of individuality, interpreting these as the outcomes, and I quote again, of the patterns of behavior that mark out the activities of any group, family, clan, people, section, faction, class, end of quote. But, and this is the key point, the significance that Dewey accords culture in this mix is above all a practical one, a governmental one. It is, he says, culture is the mediating surface on and through which government, guided by science, must act to shape the passions, desires, and interests, not of raw individuals, but of individuals as members of different groups. And it must, he said, do so in ways that will allow a balanced apportionment of the relations between government and freedom. Culture, he says, provides science, these are his words, with a means of shaping the desires that motivate social action, that is, and I quote, not exercised directly upon individuals, but indirectly through their incorporation within culture. It is, and I'm quoting again, only through the medium of culture that science may shape human desires and purpose without intruding unduly on political freedoms. Similarly, the end toward which such activity must be directed, he says, is that of producing a culture that, and I quote, conceives and begets political freedom as its accompaniment and its consequence, end of quote. Although he doesn't name him in this book, the concept of culture that Dewey has in mind is that which, conventionally attributed to Franz Boas's work, became the defining feature of American anthropology as this was shaped in the interwar generation by Boas, and that's a picture of Boas dressed as an Eskimo, bringing, I picture this because it's typical of the kind of like the cross-dressing of anthropologists at this period, bringing his fieldwork back home dressing as an Eskimo, as you can see. The concept of culture, however, was originally proposed, culture as a way of life, originally proposed by Franz Boas, but continued to be developed and refined and changed by a generation of his students, including Clark Whistler, Alfred Kerber, and in particular, Ruth Benedict, who worked among the Blackfoot. Franz Boas and John Dewey were colleagues at Columbia University in New York. Boas offered Dewey advice on the role of social and cultural factors in shaping ethical norms. And the two corresponded in 1939 on questions of freedom and the need, as Boas put it, and I quote, for the state to further the conditions in which individuals can freely develop their abilities, so far as this is possible with a full understanding of the fetters imposed upon us by tradition, end of quote. And if Dewey called upon science to help shape the ends and means of governmental action, Boas's concept of anthropology was the very model of a science deployed in the service of a revised liberalism of the kind that Dewey had in mind. Deeply shaped by German liberal political thought and by the liberal cultural technologies of the self, fostered by the tradition of Bildung, Boas transformed the methods of inherited that he inherited. He transformed these were by and large the methods of physical anthropology, measuring bodies and so on and so forth. Boas transformed the methods of anthropology that he inherited in order to open up and extend the possibilities for freedom by demonstrating the plasticity and malleability of human attributes. He was, but at the same time deeply committed to a liberal, high modernist conception of science as an autonomous field of practice that should stand outside of and resist subordination to state authorities, circulating instead in the relations between the scientific community, the state and civil society, the ultimate responsibility of science and of anthropology as a science was to govern through and so as to further secure human freedoms. But I'm less interested in Boas's personal advocacy in such matters than in the role that the concept of culture, conventionally attributed to him, played in a much larger and more mobile and more concrete set of practical histories. These are, to recall my opening remarks, histories that are shaped, that need to be approached by considering how the concept of culture helped to shape and be shaped by distinctive anthropological assemblages as mixtures of men, materials, ideas, technologies, tools, and so on. Anthropological assemblages that were forged in the relations between field, museum, and university in which anthropology was developed at this point in time, and also anthropological assemblages that need to be considered in relation to parallel developments in social science methods, particularly social science over the same period, and their relations to governmental programs. But for today, I'm going to focus principally on the concept of culture. And so let's start with one of Boas's definitions of culture. Culture, he wrote, embraces all the manifestations of the social habits of a community, the reactions of the individual as affected by the habits of the group in which he lives, and the products of human activities as determined by these habits. This concept of culture, proposed by Boas, was subsequently elaborated by many post-Boasian anthropologists, but including by Alfred Kreber and Clyde Kluckhohn, who offered the following definition as a summary of the concept in their 1952 review of the history of the concepts, the history of different concepts of culture. Culture, they wrote, consists of patterns, explicit and implicit, of and for behavior acquired and transmitted by symbols, constituting the distinctive achievements of human groups, including their embodiment in artifacts. The essential core of culture consists of traditional, that is, historically derived and selected ideas, and especially their attached values, culture systems, may on the one hand be considered as products of action, and on the other, as conditioning elements of further action. It's the importance of action in this definition I want to stress there. But Kreber and Kluckhohn present this, and Boas's definition of culture, as elaborations of or further developments of a definition of culture that had been proposed a generation earlier by the English anthropologist Edward Burnett Tylor in his 1870 book Primitive Culture. Kreber and Kluckhohn present Boas's definition and Tylor's definition as the two milestones on the road leading away from, as they put it, European and aesthetic conceptions of culture toward an American and scientific concept of culture of the kind that they wanted to establish. This is what Tylor said about culture. Culture, or civilization, taken in its wide ethnographic sense, is that complex whole which includes knowledge, belief, art, morals, law, custom, and any other capabilities and habits acquired by man as a member of society. But there are, as more recent work has made clear, important differences between Boas's concept and that of Tylor. For Tylor, culture as a way of life is just a set of traits. For Boas and his followers, those traits, and I'll indicate shortly why this is so important, those traits are regarded as being configured into a distinctively patterned whole. And it's this distinctively patterned whole that is the essence of culture, not just a list of traits. But secondly, Tylor never placed the concept of primitive culture in parentheses, whereas Boas, when he talked about primitive culture, always placed it in parentheses to question the notion that there was a distinction between primitive and civilized cultures. Boas and his followers argued that such cultures possessed an integrity that should be accorded equal value and worth with the cultures of developed societies, whereas for Tylor, primitive cultures were survivals of past ages that ought to be reformed off the face of the earth through colonial practices. But let me now come to the histories of the concept. These consisted not, this is the paradox that I want to be concerned with, Boas and all of his followers as anthropologists were anthropologists who worked mainly with Native American tribes on the West Coast or the Plains Indians. But the lessons that they derived from their anthropology were applied on the East Coast in the administration of a new multicultural America. I'll elaborate that point now in a bit more detail. So far as the practical history of the concept of culture forged by Boas and his followers is concerned, this consisted not in its application to the administration of Indian affairs, but rather in how anthropology deployed the lessons of its fieldwork gained among Native Americans in order to intervene indirectly, liberally, in the governance of an emerging multicultural America. The key issues here pivot on the different ways in which the concepts of race and culture were invoked in adjudicating the relations between mainstream America, Native Americans, and the influx of migrants into America's northeastern states from both Europe and post-emancipation of African Americans from the US's southern states. The work of the American scholar Stephen Scon is especially valuable here in highlighting the shifts in the discursive frameworks through which the relations between settler and indigenous populations were mediated in late 19th and early 20th century America, as Native Americans were progressively removed from the spheres of historical writing and painting to figure exclusively as the timeless subjects of anthropological discourse. And most recent assessments agree with Stephen Conn that Boas's concept of culture, while validating the integrity of Native Americans' ways of life, also provided a rationale for the preservation of Native Americans in a state outside of history, stuck in a permanently frozen anthropological present. And we see this in the consequences of this in Boas's 1911 book, The Mind of Primitive Man. When at the end of this book, Boas addresses the practical lessons to be derived from anthropology for the administration of race relations in the United States, he discounts Native Americans as being too insignificant, both in their overall numbers and in their contribution to the racial composition of the American population through miscegenation, to be of any continuing practical significance. His practical interests focused rather on the need for more dynamic assimilationist programs to be applied to European migrants and African Americans. These cultures, Boas argued, provided evidence of a cultural vitality which, through racial intermixture, would enrich America's racial stock. The practical lessons he drew from his fieldwork among the Kwakiutl were thus paradoxically brought to bear more or less exclusively on the management of the relations between, on the one hand, the descendants of earlier generations of Anglo and European migrants to the United States, and on the other, the US's newly emancipated African Americans and its new immigrant populations, who from the 1890s through to the 1920s were flooding into the northeastern states at an unparalleled rate. The uneasy tension between liberal and biopolitical formulations that characterized Boas's early work is resolved increasingly in favor of the former in Boas's later work, but more especially in the elaboration of the culture concept undertaken by the generation of his PhD students who were his immediate successors: Clark Whistler, Alfred Kerber, Goldenweiser, A.A. Goldenweiser, Ruth Benedict, and Margaret Mead are among the key figures here. Robert Lowy too. I cannot attempt a comprehensive history or comprehensive review of this history here, but there are four general features that stand out that I want to highlight. The first consists in the democratic extension of the concept of culture to encompass practices outside the conventional high arts. This aspect of the culture, of the concept of culture developed by anthropologists at this point in time, was to play a key role in the post-war development of cultural studies in Britain and in Australia and elsewhere. But it's a concept that was very clearly enunciated by Robert Lowy in his 1917 book, Culture and Ethnology, This is a democratic extension of the concept of culture some 40 years before cultural studies, right? The fact that your boy plays button-button, who has the button, is just as much an element of our culture as the fact that a room is lighted by electricity. So is the baseball enthusiasm of our grown-up population. So are moving picture shows, thé dansants, Thanksgiving Day, masquerades, barrooms, Siegfried Midnight Follies, evening schools, the Hearst Papers, woman suffrage clubs, the single tax movement, Riker drugstores, touring sedans, and Tammany Hall. So a democratic extension of the concept of culture is one aspect. A second aspect of the concept consists in the concern to establish the autonomy of culture relative to biologically hereditable determinations of conduct. Culture, as Ruth Benedict put it, and I'm quoting, culture is not a biologically transmitted complex. By and large, until then, it had been thought to be that. The culture was carried, determined by biological forces. Culture is not a biologically transmitted concept. Not a biologically transmitted complex, she argues. The third principle consists in the role accorded aesthetic principles of ordering in the emerging conception of culture as, in Ruth Benedict's economical summary, a distinctively patterned whole. A distinctively patterned whole, which she likens to, and I quote it, she says, the ways in which the patterns of culture are formed is like that, and I quote, by which a style in art comes into being and persists. Boas had a similar notion. For Boas, in reworking the role that Kant attributed to genius, Boas attributes the distinctive quality of a culture to the genius of its people, as best represented by its artists and philosophers. The fourth aspect of the concept of culture I want to comment on consists in the autonomy of culture relative to any specific environment. As Boas's follower Goldenweiser put it, all cultures finally are historical complexes. Every culture combines with traits that have originated within its own borders other traits that have come from without, from other cultures, and have become amalgamated with the recipient culture. Now these foreign traits are obviously independent of the environment of the recipient culture. Thus, as a historical complex, every culture is largely independent of its environment. This meant that culture became something that could be acted upon autonomously as an entity in its own right, rather than something that was socially or environmentally or geographically or whatever determined. It emerges as a thing in itself to be acted on. It was the combination, then, of these different aspects of the concept that allowed culture, understood as an aesthetically ordered way of life that is autonomous in relationship to other determinations, to be fashioned as a new transactional reality, a new working surface on the social for managing the relations between populations in movement in a multicultural America. It shifted the definition of questions of assimilation from racial coordinates to ones to be affected by liberal techniques of governing at a distance that were to work through an understanding of an adjustment to the ordering principles governing the distinctive patterns of different ways of life that were brought together by different communities within a multicultural America. This was a new object in the field of knowledge. It was a brand new object in the field of knowledge. A new working surface on the social that was shaped from within by the problematics of liberal government. When two others of Boas's students, Melville Herskovich and Malcolm Wiley, explore the implications of anthropology for the practical concerns of sociology, they first note Boas's demonstration of the limitations of race and environment for understanding and engaging with, as they put it, the bewildering variety of human behavior. End of quote. In then identifying what like primitive cultures, in quotes, but still primitive cultures, as represented by, and I'm quoting again, the study of our own North American Indians might throw on these matters, it's the concept of the patterned ordering of the relations between the different traits that comprise a culture that is singled out for its practical significance. The immigrant, but its practical significance for the immigrant, not for the Native American. The immigrant who comes to this country is acculturated to a different pattern from the one which he finds here in the process of becoming American is a bewildering one. If those who insist on registration laws and 4th of July orations as measures of Americanization were more conversant with the workings of the culture pattern and the relations of the individual to it, there might be more efficiency and less heartburning in this process. The concepts of good and bad which we apply in cultural judgments fade before the broadness of vision which is consequent upon an application of the workings of the cultural pattern. Comprehension that cultural patterns arise through historical processes, that they are unconscious in their development and capricious in the extreme, is essential to the one who would undertake the difficult problem of social control or amelioration. There was, however, another aspect to the history of the practical history of the anthropological concept of culture. And this consisted in the use of other cultures as a device for defamiliarizing our own cultures and our relations to and within them. Ruth Benedict takes this tack in her Patterns of Culture, while arguing that the evidence of anthropology had by then disproved that there was any essential distinction, and I quote, between ourselves and the primitive, end of quote. She maintains that primitive cultures, those of Native Americans, can still serve a useful purpose if they're thought of as laboratories for studying processes of cultural formation. All cultures which have been shaped through histories that have had little contact with our own, she argues, as cultures which have been shaped through histories that have little contact with our own, primitive cultures provide a point of critical contrast from which we might gain insight into the particularity of our own cultural values, and in the process identify qualities which we might want to call into question and from which we might want to unpick ourselves within our own culture. This was a conception of culture in which modernist science and modernist aesthetics combined in a conception of the culture of the indigenous other as a defamiliarizing device that might be used to bring the cultures of mainstream America under the microscope. This, it was argued, would provide liberal Americans with a resource for practices of aesthetic self-fashioning that would take their cue from the insights into the self, organized from anthropology's lessons of comparative cultural difference. We see this clearly in a quote from Herskovitz and Wiley. It is not surprising, then, they write, that the sociologist immersed in the culture of his own group should have missed quite completely the importance of that culture itself as the element by which he might explain the problems which puzzle him. It is perhaps one of the most confusing characteristics of our culture that we are quite unconscious of, almost as much as we are of the air we breathe. We've been born into it, and our responses have been completely conditioned by it. It is only when we consider cultures as different from our own as those of primitive people that we begin to see the workings of culture, and by implication, that we can rework how culture works us so as to change ourselves and to change our relations to one another within a multicultural America. Yet, though this is a footnote really to my main line of argument, such applications of the culture concept were rarely entirely freed from the evaluative assumptions of the earlier aesthetic conceptions of culture it was pitched against. More particularly, the reverberation of Kantian conceptions of culture in which the capacity for free forms of agency is linked to a capacity for self-reflection, a capacity that's denied the primitive, are clearly evident. We see them in this text from Clark Whistler, another of Boas's students, in his 1923 book, Man of Culture. So in our culture, few phases of life have escaped the thinker, and the increasing momentum of accumulation is now carrying us along with startling rapidity so that religion, marriage, and even the most intimate affairs of life are bared to this penetrating life. Here lies the significance of the term primitive, for those cultures are primitive in which rationalization is relatively weakest. Primitives, he argues, are slackers in culture who have slunk back into the waylays of isolation. They have not stood still insofar as the content of their culture goes, but in the manner of rationalization, they are on the chronological level of past ages. This is one of the reasons, again, why then Native Americans are being left to go their own way. These definitional elaborations, to come now to try to tie all this together, were accompanied by a series of complex histories in which the concept of culture was put to work, sometimes by itself, sometimes in collaboration with other disciplines, particularly sociology, in governmental programs in America that were aimed at changing the conduct of specific populations. Such programs invoked the authority of the anthropologist, whose knowledge of the specific patterning of a culture provided in that pattern the transactional reality, the working surface through which governmental activity was to be brought to bear to work on and change the conduct of the population in question, but indirectly, in ways that didn't interfere with their freedom. Such activity, of course, included the activities of a range of authorities, community organizations and scientific associations, for example, alongside state agencies. As such, they were usually guided by that concern identified by Dewey to provide a means for governing that would respect the freedom and autonomy of the governed, to the extent that governing through culture provided a new and indirect means of governing that dispensed with the need for directive forms of rule. This was the case, for example, with work undertaken by Margaret Mead alongside the psychologist Kurt Lewin in the early years of the 1939-1945 war, in seeking to devise strategies for changing attitudes toward the consumption of offal in wartime America. For the approach, this was in case the supply of meat became reduced. It didn't, but it was a contingency. For the approach, this is a question of removing the cultural barriers to the consumption of offal, a task that had to be approached indirectly by seeking to change the values of shoppers, and in principle, not trying to change the values of the main eaters of meat, men, but women who were the main buyers of meat. So this was a program of trying to alter conduct, not through state-directed propaganda campaigns, but through working on culture. Well, there's a lot more that could and needs to be said about this moment in the development of the culture concept. But let me draw this aspect of my argument to a close by referring to Robert Lynn's book, Prominent Sociologist, Knowledge for What, also published in 1939, the same year as Dewey's Freedom and Culture. For this also accorded, Lind also accorded the anthropological concept of culture pride of place in a practical program for the social sciences that was to mobilize their expertise in a program for the management of freedom directed at mainstream America. But there is, Lind argues, no reason to suppose that the order, and by the order he means the order of the relation between control and freedom in any given culture, exhibits a degree of orderliness that is either rationally or humanly most serviceable. Rather, he says, if such order is to exist in culture, it must be built into it by science and not merely discovered in it. The task of social science is to discover what kinds of order actually do exist in the whole range of behavior of human beings, what kind of functional relationships between different parts of culture exist, and, this is the key point, what functionally more useful kinds of order can be created in our contemporary culture. In summary, then, we can see how the concept of culture as a way of life was entangled with the construction of the anthropologist as a new kind of authority of freedom, in which anthropological expertise, sometimes in alliance with sociology and psychology, sometimes pitted against these, was related to the organization of new historical forms of liberal government. But I want to conclude by returning to my opening remarks on the politics of method and the need to treat the role of concepts and theories as parts of method assemblages. For Boas's career and that of the culture concept testify both to the continuity of anthropology's involvement in the processes of liberal government and to the variability of the method assemblages through which that involvement was enacted. For, although he's primarily associated with the culture concept, until well into his mid-career, Boas, in the process of articulating the importance of cultural sources of human variability relative to hereditary, biological, and environmental factors, does not only draw on his fieldwork among Native Americans, but also on census data and on his own anthropometric surveys of samples of varied immigrant and African American populations. by comparing, for example, first and second generation Bohemian, Hebrew, Sicilians, and Neapolitan migrants in the US in regard to the length and width of their heads, the width of their faces, Boas's concern was to critique racial essentialisms by demonstrating the plasticity of body types across generations, and therefore the need to treat all ethnic groups equally as having the capacity to change physically through the process of immigration. Such method assemblages, ones bringing together physical together with cultural notions of anthropology, had a continuing history until well into the mid-century period, although not always leading to liberal conclusions. Anthropometric methods of racial sorting were indeed revived in the midst of the 1939 to 1945 war in the US in discussions regarding the contribution that anthropology might make to the task of managing the US's anticipated post-war refugee intake by establishing a hierarchy of desirable and undesirable racial types. But the intellectual tide was running in the opposite direction, as under the influence of the culture concept, the methods of American anthropology were increasingly disentangled from those method assemblages that had their roots in biology and natural history and became allied instead to social surveys, participant observation, and interview techniques designed to ascertain not the plasticity of body types, but the mobility and adaptability of migrant cultures in their new American setting. Thank you.
Bueno, como es habitual, vamos a dar paso a las preguntas después de la conferencia de Tony. Debería haber un micrófono por ahí circulando. ¿Preguntas? Allá. Sí, sí. Ahí va el micrófono.
En español, ¿no? Sí. Bueno.
Dale.
Sí, bueno, muchas gracias por la interesante conferencia que acabamos de escuchar. Y quisiera ver qué relación hace usted entre lo que sería este nuevo paradigma en la antropología, este nuevo objeto de estudio en la antropología, esta noción de cultura, y lo que sería el desarrollo, por ejemplo, de los procesos de patrimonialización respecto a la performatividad que plantea esta idea de cultura, ¿no? ¿Qué impacto tiene esta noción de cultura en la performatividad y en toda esta también noción de empoderamiento, por ejemplo, que está muy presente en todo lo que son los digamos, las intervenciones también del Estado con respecto al turismo cultural y etcétera, etcétera? No sé, esa es mi pregunta.
¿Alguien más? Ahí.
Me parece que hay una resurgimiento del concepto de cultura hoy en día en sociología, sobre todo, que está relacionado, creo, con cultura política en interacciones cotidianas. Mi pregunta es si este renuevo del concepto de cultura, o sea, ¿qué otras maneras podría reintegrarse el concepto de cultura que siento que se fue dejando de lado en la antropología por los temas de colonialismo, etcétera, y que cómo se reconcilian estas dos vetas y disciplinas?
Okay. Well, thank you for those two very challenging questions. I think I'll try to answer them in ways that bring the two questions together. Because I think that one of the things that fascinates me about the history of the culture concept as initiated by the Boas and the American tradition is how mobile it has been. And what different kinds of work it has performed in different historical contexts. All right, so that when you refer the first questioner to questions of cultural tourism today, this is part and parcel, I think, of what has been a massive multiplication of the interpretations of the concept of culture that operate in the present. And this massive multiplication of the currency of the concept of culture is a part and parcel of the massive multiplication of the ways in which culture is used in processes of governing, ordering, intervening in social life on the part of now a massive range of authorities. So it's undoubtedly the case that with regard to questions of cultural tourism, cultural heritage, that what we have to deal with are new forms of cultural authority through which the concept of culture, but also new cultural assemblages, like, for example, heritage sites, which many contemporary heritage sites are distinctive cultural assemblages that order the relations between environment, architecture, historical materials, texts, traditions, and so on, in ways, some ways that are brought to bear upon questions of identity management, for example. This is the case with the Echo Museum movement in France. But we see in the birth of things like cultural policies, cultural environment and heritage policies, we see the multiplication of culture as a resource for governing in contemporary societies. And let me now then relate that then to the second question about the contrast between the ways in which anthropology has often, you quite correctly observe, moved away from the concept of culture. This was particularly true of American anthropology, in which in the 1950s and 1960s, with post-colonial movements in the post-war period, with an interrogation of the history of the uses of the concept of culture across colonial relations, American anthropologists became increasingly hesitant about the use of the concept of culture. And this was a matter of an internal critique with the kind of the work of people like James Clifford and so on and so forth. So people became very hesitant in their handling of the concept of culture. At the same time, however, over the same period, we have seen the concept that, while anthropologists have been hesitant about using it in relationship to their traditional objects of study, its uses on the part of other disciplines have multiplied. So one of the paradoxes is that, let me think how to put this. At the same time that anthropologists are moving away from the concept of culture, the project of cultural studies gets hold of the concept of culture. And by and large, it's the same concept of culture. This isn't something that I've talked about today, but if we look at the development of the concept of culture as a way of life that informed British cultural studies through the work of people like Raymond Williams, Richard Hoggart, but also the early work of the Birmingham School, the people like Stuart Hall and so on, there is a connection with the post-Boas tradition. Indeed, when I was a student, a long time ago, I first encountered the concept of culture as a way of life through the work of Raymond Williams and through the work of Stuart Hall. For Raymond Williams in New Keywords identifies
the concept of culture as a way of life as coming from Tyler. He doesn't identify the problems with it particularly, but he also discusses the work of the of. It doesn't mention Boas, but he talks about Kerber and Kluckhohn and their 1952 book on the definition, reviewing the history of the definitions of culture. So he's conscious, he's aware of the American use of the concept of culture when he's importing it into cultural studies. And one of the key influences for the Birmingham School of Cultural Studies, particularly through what was in Britain a very influential book written by Stuart Hall and his colleagues called Resistance Through Rituals, in which they draw upon the history, they draw upon the concept of culture as a way of life. The route through which they import that is an American one. They derive the concept from the work of a generation of sociologists like White, who wrote Street Corner Society. There was a late 50s, 1960s generation of American sociologists who were drawing on the Boasian tradition in engaging with contemporary American ways of life. So at the same time that anthropologists are getting very hesitant about the concept of culture, at the same time within British cultural studies, that same concept of culture derived from that tradition is imported, but it's reworked. And originally it's reworked in the context of a politics of resistance. It's reworked in a context of a democratizing orientation toward culture. And of course, the concept has been reworked many times since in the subsequent history of cultural studies and other disciplines. So one of the things that we can say about this concept of culture has been its remarkable mobility and adaptability, so that it's been linked to intellectual and political projects in quite different ways in the course of its the history subsequent to the one that I've sketched today.
Si hay preguntas adicionales, Modesto, sí. El micrófono viene, ahí viene Francisco.
Bueno, mi pregunta es muy simple. Pensando, Tony, en la conceptualización lo que nos has estado contando, de la conceptualización de la idea de la idea de cultura. ¿Cómo ves tú en la actualidad la comunicación o las relaciones entre la sociología y la antropología? Que sí estaba, digamos, en los padres de la sociología de la cultura actual, en particular en Pierre Bourdieu. Y me da la sensación, revisando artículos, leyendo los journals, que cada vez están más autonomizados, y que buena parte de la teoría original de cultura venía de la antropología, y muchas veces los sociólogos no tenemos la teoría como para salir de esas ideas de los padres fundadores, aunque sean contemporáneos. Es decir, perdona, estamos trabajando en cultura, pero yo creo que muchas veces nos falta la teorización y la conceptualización del concepto para salir del trabajo que estamos haciendo.
Clearly you get very big questions in Santiago. Look, I think the question of the relations between anthropology and sociology and concepts of culture, these probably work out quite differently in different national contexts. So let me talk about, I can only talk about the ones that I know about. My sense would be in Britain that the two traditions have actually moved, that sociology and anthropology have moved quite closely together. I say this in the context, Modesto and I used to work in an ESRC center for research on sociocultural change. And one of the valuable aspects of that, for me, was anthropologists and sociologists and people in cultural studies working side by side. And I think that one of the things that I learned from that was that
While it's true that for the anthropologists I worked with, the concept of culture wasn't particularly important, the approaches to knowledge practices of the kind that I've outlined here, concerned with assemblages, the social life of methods, etc., these were very much shared by anthropologists and sociologists. So I see in some respects the methods of those two disciplines in Britain becoming much closer. I'm relying on secondary sources in the sense of dealing with the American anthropology, where I think that there is still a much greater hesitancy toward the concept of culture for the historical reasons that I outlined earlier. But in terms of where I work at the moment in Australia, anthropology still has a very distinctive position in the sense that it is still principally engaged with politically and analytically questions relating to Indigenous Australians. And that makes a good deal of difference to what its interfaces with other knowledge practices are. Okay.
No sé si hay alguna pregunta adicional.
Perdón, Tony, no quiero abusar, pero pensaba justamente, bueno, no quería preguntarte sobre eso, pero bueno, ya que se ha dado el espacio, sobre, y bueno, nos has hablado de los años 20, los años 30, bueno, la antropología y la colonización. Yo me gustaría saber si nos podías decir algo de esos conceptos de cultura y de la experiencia australiana, porque ellos entiendo que han cambiado, bueno, la política que tenían con respecto a la población indígena, no sé, en los últimos 30, 40 años. Es decir, si nos puedes traer ese debate algo más contemporáneo, que tú además has tenido mucha relación con Australia y que quizás conoces.
Pensando
que aquí también tiene un tema, bueno, quizás no tan tratado, que es, bueno, con la población mapuche y...
No, thank you for the question. My answer will be a little bit long because I need to provide some information. Another part of the project that I'm working on has involved me working on the history of the relations between Australian anthropology and Indigenous Australians. In particular, looking at the work of an anthropologist called Baldwin Spencer, who in the early 20th century, his work proved crucial in the exclusion of Aboriginal Australians, or Aborigines as they were then. Their exclusion from all citizenship rights. And this is largely because Spencer's fieldwork produced a racial definition of aboriginality according to which Aborigines were regarded as racially backward, and destined to die out. And therefore all that government could do was to, as it was called, smooth the dying pillow for the Aboriginal race. this smoothing the dying pillow meant placing Aborigines on special reserves, excluding them from all political entitlement, and basically seeking to manage their course to extinction. Okay. Now, the development of an Aboriginal politics of resistance begins at about the same time, in the 1930s. And progresses significantly from the 1960s onwards, very much in ways in which the Aboriginal movement learned a lot from black liberation struggles, emancipation movement in the US. And this resulted in a significant historical accomplishment when formal citizenship rights were won by Aborigines in 1967. But these have never never been quite the same citizenship rights as for other Australians. So I referred earlier on, in drawing on Foucault's work, to say that one of the things that the practices of liberal government do in the Foucauldian sense is to distinguish which populations are said to have the capacity to govern themselves freely and which populations have to be subject to more directive forms of social control and management. And this is still a very current issue in Australia with regard to the relations between mainstream Australia and Indigenous Australia. So that this has been manifest in the last 15 years or so through something that's called the Northern Territory Intervention. This was initiated under the previous Liberal government, but has been continued and extended by the current Labor government. And what it is a form of intervention into remote Aboriginal communities through which the state denies Indigenous Australians the rights and responsibilities that other Australians enjoy. It does so with a view to countering problems of drunkenness, wife beating, child abuse. This is what the government says in such communities. But it does so by, for example, banning all alcohol from such towns, denying families the freedom to spend their money where they would wish, but tying their wages to being expended in particular outlets. So there are all sorts of ways in which Indigenous Australians in such communities are not free in the same way that other Australians are. And this is a subject for great controversy within Indigenous communities, as well as within Australia generally.
So these historical patterns that were developed in the early 20th century, their legacies are still with us.
Bueno, quiero agradecerle a Tony por su magnífica conferencia. Creo que ejemplar a la hora de ver cómo referirse a la política de los métodos, prestándole particular atención a los contextos históricos. Quiero agradecerle también que nos acompañe hoy día porque viene por un viaje de 3 días desde Australia, considerando el jet lag que eso produce, es bastante heroico. Y quiero agradecerle a ustedes por su presencia y que han desde ya invitado a la próxima cátedra que va a ser en octubre, ya le informaremos el día y mantendré en reserva al invitado todavía.
Thank you, and my special thanks to the translators. Thank you.